Hello everyone, my name is Jason. Welcome back to my channel. Here's a quick question. Which version of this code is cleaner? Is it the reduced version or is it the one with object.fromEntries? A few years ago, I got into a full day discussion with a colleague over this one line of code. I was reviewing his PR and suggested replacing his reduce with the fromEntries version because that's what I thought to be cleaner and more readable. But he disagreed. He argued that the reduced version is more readable because it resembles the object notation more, you know, with all the curly braces and stuff. But I argued that object.fromEntries does exactly what he wants and nothing more. And to me, that is clearer. What started as a tiny nitpick quickly turned into a showdown of personal preferences. Neither of us could win. That's when I realized we were missing a shared framework. Something objective, something we can both agree on, and something that would prove that I'm right because I am right. I ended up spending the whole evening thinking it through, and eventually I came up with an idea that has profoundly shaped how I think about clean code. The idea was a spin-off of the rule of least power, a design principle formalized by W3C and originally proposed by Sir Tim Berners-Lee, the inventor of the web itself. But unlike the Edwards law, a meme-turned prophecy that says any application that could be written in JavaScript would be written in JavaScript, mine is a little bit more practical. But instead of calling it Jason's law, I refer to it as hashtag rope. In this video, we'll be covering three things. Firstly, what is the rule of least power? Second, how we can use it to apply to our code? And thirdly, a concept called depowering. Before we dive in, here's a word from our sponsor. I'm thrilled to announce the zero sponsor of the YouTube channel, myself. As some of you already know, I am unemployed and broke, so I desperately need your help. Here are three ways you can support me. Number one, become a GitHub sponsor. I've just recently set up my GitHub sponsors page with a first goal of 10 sponsors. If you like what I do, or the content that I'm making, or just me in general as a person, consider becoming one of my first sponsors. The link is in the description box below, do check it out. Second, buying this sponsor section. So here's a poem that ChatGPT wrote. It says, "Your product is great, I have no doubt. My rates are low, I'm starting out. So buy this now while it is small, or I'll get famous and raise it all." So yeah, please take ChatGPT's advice and reach out to me in the DMs to talk about this. Number three, hiring me. If you are working for a cool company with a great product, fun team, modern tech stack, fully remote, pays well, and hiring, feel free to reach out to me. I'm looking for a job. And last but not least, please share my videos with your friends so that I get enough views and subscribers to start monetizing on YouTube so that I can pay my bills. This is it for today's sponsor. Back to the video. Part 1. The rule of least power. Ever wondered why we have HTML, CSS, and JavaScript in the web instead of just one programming language to rule it all? Well, that's not an accident. It's very much by design. One of the guiding principles of the web is something called the rule of least power, which states that powerful languages inhibit information reuse. Back in 1989, when Sir Tim Berners-Lee invented the web, he wanted the web to be something that could be used by all sorts of programs. For example, browsers to display websites, screen readers to read websites, crawlers to extract data, search engines to index websites, and so on and so on. To make that possible, he needs a language that is super easy to parse, interpret, and to understand. So instead of a full-blown programming language, he deliberately designed HTML to be simple, almost dumb. This is all because he understood that less powerful languages are more reusable. But how exactly are less powerful languages more reusable, you might ask? Let's take a step back and imagine a power spectrum of programming languages. On the far left, the least powerful ones, we've got CSV, JSON, and HTML. These languages aren't very powerful. They're just declarative way of representing data, doesn't really have much logic in there. In the middle, we have something like regular expression, although technically not a language, but it still has a syntax to represent data, and CSS. These languages are slightly more powerful. They have their own logic in there, but not exactly as powerful as Turing complete languages. And on the right, the most powerful ones would be the Turing complete languages like JavaScript, C++, etc. So this is the power spectrum of computer languages. And if we plot these against how easy it is to parse each of them, we get something like this. As you can see, less powerful languages tend to be easier to parse, and this makes them easier to be reused by other programs. Let's take CSV as an example. CSV stands for comma-separated values. To parse it, all you need to do is to separate each line by commas. That's it. In fact, a very, very simple, naive implementation would just be two or three lines of code. Now compare that to JavaScript. To extract meaningful data from JavaScript, you'd be lucky to only need to deal with abstract syntax trees. In most cases, you'll probably need a full-blown engine to run the code to actually find out the data. So even though JavaScript is more powerful, much more powerful, CSV is more reusable. To wrap up, here are two key takeaways from the rule of least power. Firstly, powerful languages inhibit information reuse. Secondly, pick the least powerful language suitable for a given task to maximize information reuse. Part 2, applying ROLP to code. So far, we have looked at how the rule of least power helps us pick the best language for a given task. This rule is also extended to many areas in system design, but actually, it doesn't need to be that high level. The rule of least power can apply to your everyday code too. The original rule of least power states that powerful languages inhibit information reuse. If you think about the reasoning behind it, it all comes down to how easy it is to parse the language. In other words, how readable the language is to machines. The same idea applies to code, except now we are talking about readability for humans. So here's our adaptive principle. Powerful expressions or statements inhibits readability. Let's return to the example from the beginning of the video. Reduce is obviously much more powerful than object.fromEntries. This is not up for debate because Reduce can literally do anything. But why is the Reduce version more readable? Here is a trick I call the redaction test. The idea is simple. Hide some information from both versions of the code and see which one's intention is clearer. Even without the details, object.fromEntries tells us exactly what we were doing, turning entries into an object. But with Reduce, it can do anything. So in this case, object.fromEntries is clearly more readable. Let's try one more example. In this example, we want to check whether subscribe is a substring of str. By the way, if you haven't subscribed, now's a good time. Again, I guess there's not much debate that regular expression is more powerful than string.includes. So now let's compare the readability with the redaction test. Once again, the intention behind string.includes is much clearer than regular expression, because string.includes only check for substring and nothing more, whereas regular expression can do much more. So even though regular expression is more powerful, string.includes is more readable, and that makes it a better choice when all you need is substring matching. I hope this gives an overview of why less powerful expressions are more readable. The less powerful an expression is, the less it can do, and the less readers have to dive into the code to understand what's going on. So I guess this sums up how #ROLP can be applied to code. Part 3, depowering. In this final part of the video, let's talk about how we can use depowering to improve the readability of our code. As we saw earlier, more powerful expressions tend to be less readable. So one way to make our code more readable is to intentionally reduce the power of our code. Here are two ways to do that. One, depowering by abstraction. And two, depowering by convention. Depowering by abstraction. We can take power away from an expression by wrapping it in a function and name it appropriately. For example, consider this line of code. This works fine, but as demonstrated previously, reduce is very, very powerful. In all cases of reduce, you'll have to look into the implementation to understand what it does. We could fix this by wrapping the whole thing in a function called sum, and now our code just becomes sum excess. We are essentially creating a more specialized version of reduce that only sums a list of numbers. And this takes away the power of reduce by preventing it from doing anything more than just summing numbers. If we run this through the reduction test, you'll see a huge difference in readability. Depowering by conventions. By setting some team conventions, we can limit some powers of some language features, making them easier to reason about. Let's take the holy trinity of array methods, map, filter, and reduce as an example. These methods were borrowed from functional programming languages, where side effects aren't really a thing. However, in JavaScript and many other programming languages, nothing stops you from doing side effects inside them. This extra power of being able to do side effects makes the holy trinity less predictable. You can't always assume that map only maps, it sometimes do other stuff. We can take this power of being able to do side effects away from these holy trinity functions by agreeing with the team to avoid side effects in them. For side effects, we sought to use for loops or for each to signify to readers that side effects might happen here. With those conventions in place, these methods become trustworthy again. When you look at a map, you know that it's just mapping through stuff. Nothing more, no side effects whatsoever. I believe that many of you and your team might have been doing this subconsciously already, but I hope this gives you a better way to formalize the reasoning behind it. And that wraps up today's video. To recap, here are three things we talked about today. One, the original rule of least power. Second, how we can use ROLP in code. And thirdly, we talk about depowering code through abstraction and convention. I hope this video helped you make better decisions at every line of code you write. If you found this video useful, share it with your team and try making ROLP part of your coding culture. Also, don't forget to like and subscribe, it really helps the channel grow. And lastly, I would love to hear from you. What are your thoughts on applying ROLP in your code? Will you be suggesting this to the team? Let me know in the comments. I read and reply to every single one, so do comment and let me know what you think. Thanks for watching, I'll see you in the next one.